Welcome to my talk about office automated updater look. I've presented some of them already at Boston. This is now an updated version with a bit more details and a bit more progress. So why did I decide to work on the automatic updater? About I think 3 years ago, I worked on the version portal that was also presented in the PSC talk, and we had one really, really bad release, 5.2 or 4.2, with some horrible shutdown crashes that were dominating our crash reports for a long time. And actually, even today, there's still 1,000 daily crash reports for that release, despite the release being released about early 2017, I think. So even now, we have, I think, now 600 or other companies and 1,000 crashes really, really old release. And nobody is updating despite experienced crashes. There are 1.1 million crashes for that version, and still people are using these old versions. The other motivation for that is, I'm not sure if you can see it, it shows here the numbers of crash reports for the featured versions. If you can see the two newest versions here have 400, 600 crash reports, but we don't know what it really means. Are there just more users? Or, for example, our newer version may be worse. We introduce a regression that causes many more crashes. Can we detect an improvement in quality, for example, between 6.0 and 6.1 in the number of crashes that we get reported? Or can we detect a huge spike in numbers, like the 5.2 to 4? Numbers, they were quite visible, but what happens if it's much smaller? We can't detect it individually. The solution, at least for that, would be to divide the number of crash reports that we get each day for each version by the number of users. But for that, we would need an accurate number for the users that are using our versions each day. And the problem is that as soon as we have an update that checks every 7 days for an update, we can get some accurate numbers for the active daily users for each day just by counting the update requests. So let's look at the different components involved in the update. First, a high level overview. I decided not to implement an own updater code, instead take the Mozilla updater code, it's called MAR, and we use that for LibreOffice. It's well tested, they have done a security audit of their code, they have done the binary diff tools, how to apply the diffs again, and so on. It has been merged to master, and it's hidden behind the configure flag. But nowadays, there's a daily build, at least for Linux, that produces an updated build that you can use. On Windows, the situation is much more complicated. I'm currently producing these builds from time to time on my local machine, because in the end, I can't handle yet Windows installations in system locations.
But excuse me, but the microphone
is flashing,
may
stop
working
soon, so maybe we can work. Okay. So currently implementing updates that I produce are in the range of 1 to 10 megabytes for daily build, so plus between 1 or 2 days. Which is much better than the 200 megabytes full installation. During the startup of the process, every 7 days, we would request an update check from our update server, where we upload our version, so the build ID, the OS information, the languages that we need, and it returns a small here it still says XML snippet, but by now it's a JSON snippet with information about the potential update files that are available for us. If there are updates available, the LibreOffice instance then goes to the download server and requests that file with the URL provided by the update server. As a separation of these two services, instead of directly providing the file, because we now just need to make sure that the update server is completely under our control, the LibreOffice download server can still be one of the mirrors that we use, because the update server provides the hash information and size information of the update files, which are later checked after downloading them from the download server. At the end here, the downloaded files are validated against the information at the bottom from the update server to make sure that the files are valid, that the signatures on them are correct, the size and hash are correct, so that everything is okay before we go further and actually apply the update. Applying the update is a simple step process. It's especially complicated on Windows. So we have our own LibreOffice instance through which forks the update executable and then kills itself. In the next step, our update executable starts, at least on Windows, the update service, because in the end we want to update a LibreOffice instance in a system location where our normal LibreOffice is not able to write to. That updater service does nothing else than checking signatures and then recalling our updater executable now in a privileged process which can actually write to the system location. That updates our LibreOffice instance and then restarts LibreOffice again. We need that complicated setup at least on Windows, because on Windows we are not able to override files that are still open, so we can't update the running LibreOffice instance. But on Linux, we won't use the updater for release builds, but only for daily QA builds. We don't need an updater service if we won't support updating the system locations, only the user locations, and on Linux it's much easier because we can update files that are still open. The update service on Windows, it's special. It's not yet completely integrated into my update process because I still have some work to do to get it into our MSI files, but to get it installed correctly. There's still a bit of work necessary to make sure that it's registered correctly in Windows, but it's one of the high priority missing pieces that currently block me from getting it to the users. Then there's a small updater server that provides these small updater snippets that has all the information about our update, our updates. It's written as a Django Python server. It just stores hash, size, location of our update files, the IDs, and for partitional updates, the source and target build IDs. The idea that I have, and that's partly implemented already, is that each ping that is registered in a database, just the build ID, the OS version, and the languages, so that we can get accurate user information, how many users were
using the process in this day just by doing a simple database query. The update is available on GitHub. It's also already running on one of the TDF VMs and works actually quite well for the data builders already. If one of our builds tries to get the information, if there's an update available, it sends one of these calls that URL like one above. First part is the URL of the address of the server, and the update check part is to tell it to just check if an update is available. Versions. The next one is the product string, the build ID, the OS version, and then the last part is to be able to support different update channels. Like we want to be able to support enterprise users, so basically people only updating from our still builds, and people updating more just from the fresh builds. Here we have a part of the of the response from the server. Here the first part is the URL of the update file, the hash function, the actual hash, and the size, which then I use later to check that the downloaded update file is correct. And Windows inside is a bit more complicated than Linux, where we can just use the Mozilla code. Mozilla is not using inside for their updates or for their builds. MSI has its own update format. It's called MSP. And yeah, these MSP files require special handling to get updates, generate update files generated correctly. Currently, we have some support for that in the office build, but it's tightly integrated in our build system. And actually, what I would like to do is take two MSI files, give it to the MSI MSP scripts, and generate an MSP file just from these two MSI files. That's not possible in the current office build system. We generate a special kind of installation file that's different from the normal MSI that we generate. And it makes it really, really difficult to change stuff. So in the end, I decided to extract most of the functionality, but change a bit the code. So now I use normal MSI files that are generated in the office build, and extract them, generate an MSP, set all the configurations, I package the PCP file, which contains all the update information, how to generate them, which information to set in the MSP file. And that's available, it's a GitOffice MSP generator. It's a small Python script that it calls into the Microsoft MSI MSP. Sadly, my MSP files are not perfect yet, so that there are some general problems. That, for example, your project ID is not allowed to change if you want to generate MSP files. But our project IDs in our builds are usually random, except if you force them to be stable. I'm still looking into solutions for that to generate stable MSP files that are always in one. And then the last part is that having these automatic updates introduces a totally new problem for testing, for making sure that our builds are correct. Suddenly you have the normal builds that are usually tested in the release. By the release builder, by executing our tests. But what happens with the old builds that are updated, but that these still work, that all the tests run, it's impossible need to find a way to at least make sure that these bills generated by taking an old bill line update actually work and produce basically the same bill and a new process bill just coming from the county. My best idea for that is using a bit of UNO and the UI testing, so that in theory we could run all the UI tests against both kinds of bills, and all the API tests should be able to run against both kinds of bills. But I'm still working out on this stuff. That's still ready to see how to make sure. That's all.